Blog Talk Radio.
Quantum Healing with Candace. I'm your host, Candace Craw Goldman. This program was created to assist humans in this rapidly changing world. And while it's expanding into new realms, it is based on the foundation of the late, great Dolores Cannon's work. So thank you, Dolores, for continuing to encourage us to explore new directions. Also, thank you to Greg Prescott and Michelle Walling at in5d.com for making this show possible. With humanity's new understanding and acceptance of the quantum world and the role that consciousness plays in shaping both our individual and our collective reality, we have plenty of subject material. I am a full-time practitioner of Dolores' hypnosis method, and I've had the honor and privilege of working with and alongside of her for several years. You can find out more about my practice of quantum healing and my consulting and coaching services at newearthjourney.com. I'd like to mention that I'm offering my own new quantum healing service that's available remotely. Call or email me about how we can create your very own unique quantum healing process. And lastly, before we get started tonight, for those of you who are looking for a practitioner of Dolores' method of quantum healing, you may find these wonderful people at DoloresCannonQHHT.com. That's DoloresCannonQHHT.com. Also, if you'd like to participate on the show tonight, you can log into the chat room or you can call into the show. That number is 646-716-8890. That's 646-716-8890. Today is January 15th, 2016, and this is the first live show of the brand new year. And we have some interesting new information for, I believe, many of us out there regarding some ET activity and stories that have been happening down in Mexico with our friends south of the border. My guest tonight is Raul Medina. I've had truly the great pleasure of meeting Raul back in, I think it was about 2013, when he was attending a class with Dolores Cannon, where I was assisting. He's been a friend and a member of Dolores' original support forum community since that time. And I can truly say he is one of the finest people with one of the biggest hearts that you might ever want to meet. Raul describes his life as growing a family and living in a rural area of the state of Jalisco. I hope I'm saying that right, Mexico, where he produces vegetables and legumes, grains, and fruits following the natural agriculture approach. He works as a consultant, and he trains farmers and forms scholars and educates companies on the ways of natural agriculture. And Raul also has a family. Can you tell? I can hear them in the background. And Yes. And of course, he's got two young kids, and they're making themselves known, I think. And of course, he's a quantum healing practitioner in the tradition of Dolores Cannon. And he has some fascinating stories to tell us this evening, primarily ET-related. Well, welcome to the show, Raul. Are your kids going to let you participate tonight?
I hope so. Because I can tell more than they can do. They can. Well, thank you very much for inviting me, Kanda. I'm very glad to be here in this show with the people that are following you, and in this opportunity of sharing some information fresh from south border of the state.
Well, we're so happy to have you, and I want to say that we're working on a phone connection tonight. So those of you in the chat room, keep us on our toes about how the sound is coming through, and we're going to do the best we can to overcome sometimes some limited technology we have here. You know, this is the first time that Raul has been on the show, so, you know, the listeners want to hear a little bit about who you are, Raul, how you got into what you're doing right now, how you learned about Dolores Cannon, you know, how you found out about these ETs, a little bit about you and your life. Tell us a little bit about yourself, would you?
Sure, with pleasure. Well, as I mentioned in my bio, I was living in a spiritual community for a big part of my life, like 24 years. And mostly, I was working with agriculture all the time, even though I did some community service. But I was wondering why all my fellows, my brothers and sisters from the community, they all were trained academically on different activities or knowledge regarding to working with people. But I was the only one that was working with plants. I do love it. And I was very happy, and I'm still very happy doing this. But there was a time, like 3 years ago, that I started wondering why I was working with plants instead of humans. You know, like, you know, I know how to heal a plant. I know how to feed a plant. I know how to grow them and so on. But I was not so much into working with people. So that was like an idea that came into my mind, a concern, I would say. And I began to, you know, think. Why was that? What was the reason for it? And when I started thinking this, a friend sent me a link to one of Dolores' videos, and I saw the video in YouTube, and I got immediately captured by Dolores and all her knowledge, what she was saying. And I started, of course, listening and viewing many videos as much as I could get from the YouTube, from the internet. Then I got into her page and I started seeing that she had books, and I started buying the books. I bought like 10 books at once and what time, and I started reading the books. Yeah, I really got caught with Dolores. I was really thrilled by what she was telling, you know, this idea of the convoluted universe and how it twist your mind as a pretzel. It really happened to me. I had an idea when I started reading Dolores. I had a vision of the cosmos, of humanity, of ourselves. And then after a year of reading and reading about what she's saying, I totally opened to something different. I expand my beliefs. I expand my limits on what I, you know, could reach or be interested on. So this keeps going. So one day I was in Europe. My wife is from Czech Republic. She's from Prague. And we were there with the family there, visiting my family, you know, being in the summertime. And I start thinking that, okay, I read about Dolores and what she's saying a lot. I have read about ETs what she's saying about ETs. But this is like when you want to start a relationship with a person. I mean, you can see romantic movies or maybe read romantic novels. But there is a time that you want to go live. You don't want to keep reading or just watching movies, you know, about the relationship. You want to really get into it, right? So that was my thing,
yes.
My big conclusion with ET. I say, okay, it's fine. I'm reading about them. It's wonderful. I'm learning and everything. But, you know, I want to be a little more, you know, I wanted to touch, you know, I wanted to be able to smell or do something else different. So that was when I decided to take, you know, myself go into a quantum healing hypnotic session or therapy. And I look in Europe for a practitioner. The first I found was Jeroen Devi. He has the same last name that I do. My actual name is Raul Medina Devi. And so I thought, well, maybe this is family, so I should try with this guy. But he moved from Dutch land to California. He was not living anymore in Europe. So I say, okay, this is not a guy. So I finally met Susanne Rasmussen. She's from Copenhagen. And I got in touch with her through internet, emails. And she accepted. She said, okay, but I won't go there. You have to come here. And I said, well, no problem. I will do that. So I went there, and it was also my birthday. It was my the day of my birthday when I decided to visit her and take the session. So it was a huge experience. And after that, I was wondering if QHT would be something I would, you know, get connected to grow myself, or should I be doing for, you know, working with other people? That was my next question. So it took me like a year to decide. And next year, I was again in Europe in the summertime. I was spending some 3 weeks in a community, a spiritual community of a teacher, a spiritual teacher that Suzanne introduced me to. Her name is Shanti Mayi. She's actually from the United States, but she mainly works in France, in Copenhagen, and Germany. And she has a very nice place, like a ashram, in the south of France, in the Pyrenees, in a very magical place. There's a huge portal. It says to be the bigger portal to other dimensions in Europe is Mount Canigou. There's also a story of Salvador Dalí, that he went to a closed town in France. The name is Perpignan. And that town has a railroad station where he sat, and he was sucked by the portal in Mount Canigou. And then he painted one of his famous paints of that experience that he had, that he was sucked by the portal. And the painting, I think, is called the Perpignan Railroad Station, something like that, very close to that. So I was experiencing all that. And then I had a free day, and I went to the little town, the next little town, and went to the flea market. And while I was there, I took a peek at internet, because we didn't have internet there. And I saw that the Dolores Cannon was coming to Mexico, to Guadalajara, which is a town that is 2 hours away from where I live. And she was, in the beginning, going to go to Argentina and do the level one class there. But for some reason, she canceled Argentina and went and decided to move it to Mexico, to Guadalajara. So you can guess that was my answer. And the funny part is that she was going to do the class 6 days after I was returning from Europe to Mexico. So I didn't doubt it too much. I didn't talk about it too much. I just, registered to the class. And as soon as I was in Mexico, I got in contact with them. And then that August 2013, I was taking the Dolores Cannon level one class. And next year, I was in level two class in Arkansas, where you and I met, finally, because we met before to the original support forum. And it was really nice. It was a huge experience being in Arkansas. Many things happened there for me. It was really impressive.
I think a lot of things happen to you no matter where you go. You know, thank you so much for that story right now. You know, Raul, I started out as a painter, and I didn't know that story about Salvador Dali and the portal. That was really interesting. Thanks for sharing that one. So, well, that's how you found Dolores. And so you've been practicing not only your farming methods, but you've been practicing QHHT since then.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
And
yes.
And tonight we're most interested in hearing about your ET stories primarily. So the way that Dolores's support forum works is, you know, practitioners, we share notes and we compare stories and we support each other. And so back in fall of last year, Raul posted this story about this adventure that he had about meeting this certain fellow named Alberto, I believe, and then a QHHT session that followed with it. And it's just such a fascinating, amazing story. And that's how we've come together today on the radio is to hear about this. Now, the most interesting thing is, for me, and I think, you know, for a lot of people who might be listening who are, you know, sort of junkies about these kinds of things, is this fellow
okay.
Alberto, I wanted to research, you know, to find out about him before our radio show tonight. And, you know, there's many YouTubes out there, but absolutely every one of them is in Spanish. And I'm just a one language kind of person, unfortunately. So I think there's a lot of us who are in the same boat. If we don't speak Spanish, we've never heard anything about this fellow. And so, you know, we'd love to have the opportunity for you to tell us how it is that, you know, you found out about him, a little bit about him, and how that set you off on your ET adventure. Will you just tell us the story?
Sure. With pleasure. Yes. As you and I were talking in the morning, there were several of my friends that went to this level one class that Dolores did in Guadalajara, Mexico. Actually, there were 11 of my friends who took the training on quantum healing hypnotic therapy. And some of them live in Guadalajara, very close to me, and we meet frequently. And we work together. We exchange sessions. We do a lot of stuff together. Some research, of course. And many of them, the other group of them, six of them, they live in the north of Mexico, in Monterrey, which is quite far away from here, but it's in the north part of Mexico. And I don't see them that often, but we still in touch. And every time there was a Dolores class, we all got together, came to the class, the training, and then, you know, everybody went back to their own activities. But to the ones that are connected with me, the ones that live in very close to me, there are three of them who we meet almost once a week, or sort of, sometimes even more often, or sometimes we take a little day to see each other. But anyway, after taking the level two class in April in this year, Dolores came to Mexico last year, sorry. Dolores came here, and she gave us the level two class. was not in April, it was before. But anyway, it was 6 months before she passed off. And some of my friends, they decide to go to visit another guy from Peru. His name is Sixto Paz. He's also one of these ET guys who like Alberto Secua, the one we are going to talk about, that we actually met before, like 4 years before. And he's very, very active in Latin America talking about ETs. So my friends decide to go on a tour with them, with him. They went to Chile, and then went there. From there, they went to in Spanish, it's Pascua Island. Island. I don't know how it's the name in English. Is that island in the South Pacific, where there are these huge heads, many of them, you know, hundreds of them along the island, the island, and nobody understands what those faces are. Just the face, the head of the totems. It's not the whole thing. They are made of stone and they're very huge. But this is a very magical place, and it has a lot of stories with ETs also. So my friends went there, and they took the tour with Sixto Paz and had a lot of experiences, and he was explaining a lot of what he had learned from the ETs and so on. Then with the other people that were in the tour, there was a woman from Houston, Texas. She's an alchemist. And my friends and I, we are starting to work a little bit with herbs and doing some preparations, some information we got from the sessions and some we already got before. So my friends make a good acquaintance with this woman from Houston, the alchemist. And she eventually invited them to go there and take a course of alchemy. So they went there. This is a couple of doctors, Norma and Luis. Both of them are doctors. And they went to see her and stayed like a week. And she trained them, giving them a small course of alchemy. And when they were there, this woman, if my friends have already met Alberto Secua, they didn't know who this guy was. They never heard about him before. And the woman said, well, you should go and see him. And she didn't explain much, but she recommended highly to see him. So when they returned to Mexico, they contact Alberto Secua, and finally he was going to give a conference in a city. I don't remember the city. And my friends and the other friends that they are also practitioners, went to hear the conference with Alberto Secua. And after that, they came back to Guadalajara to me about him. And they say, well, we do have to go and take a course with him. And I say, well, who's this guy? And he starts to explain he was a contactee for almost 40 years. And he has a lot of information that was very important regarding what's coming on to the earth, what's going to happen, how things are going to change, and a lot of information that it is important to understand, to get familiar with it, and so on. So my friends arranged with Alberto Secua to finally, he was going to dedicate a weekend for ourselves, for our group. So we finally went 14 on what he does to his place, which is in the east coast of Mexico, like in the middle of the Mexico, in a state called Hidalgo, in a town called Tulancingo. The name of the town is Tulancingo. It's like, I don't know, I think I drive like 9 hours to go there from my place. It's quite far from here. But anyway, we decided that we were going to take the course with him. And from the 14 people that we went, 11 are practitioners, QHTT practitioners. So we were, you know, very interested on many levels to hear this guy.
Mm-hmm.
So finally, we went to see the guy. That was the date, and we went there. some of my friends flew. I drive with all the friends and so on. And then, okay, so before I talk about the course, I will tell something about Alberto Seco and the things that I got to know until now. Is that right?
Yes, please. Okay. Yes, because so many of us have absolutely no idea who this fellow is. I mean, I've seen lots of, you know, the YouTubes, and he's telling stories out there. So if you could encapsulate some of his stories for us English-speaking only folk, we would really love that.
Sure. Okay. Of course, I had met him for a few months, and I had to take his word, to be true of everything that he said. But we have a good tool, which is the QHTT technique that Dolores taught us. So I was able to do a session with one of my colleagues, and everything that he said with the ET directly. Isn't that wonderful?
You're checking up on it. Okay, I love it. All right, how did that go?
Yeah, because I won't come to your show and talk about Alberto Seco, about things that I don't really, you know, confirm by myself, right? Because I will be promoting someone that could be a liar or could be someone wonderful, but I wouldn't know. So, what I'm going to say is the things that, some biographic things from him that are not, I don't have to check with the ETs, but some other ones that are very important about the events that are going to happen in the world, those I wanted really to check, and I want to know about this guy even more. So we did our own research. So this is the information about Alberto. He explained to us that he, from his 20s, he got in contact with the ETs, and actually they contact him. He was one day, in nature, in a place close to Mexico City, where it's all woods and forests. And he, for some reason, he got away or separated from his friends and walked through a path. And then he reached like a little plateau where there was no trees, there were not many trees. And then one ET showed him, manifest to him. He saw the ship. He saw a huge light, and he approached the light, and there was one ET there. And he said that he was ready to run, but he was kind of frozen. He couldn't move. He couldn't, I think he peed. And that was all he could do.
Right.
Because he was so frightened. But then the ET approached him, look at him, and he started feeling like, calm, and the fear start to fade away. And then suddenly he was like, I'm really comfortable with this guy. And so the ET starts explaining to him a lot of stuff and saying that they choose him and they want to work with him. And this was just the beginning. And so he's been in touch for 40 years. He explained to us that he has been in ships already many times, traveled to many places, and he was giving some instructions, some information, some teaching, and he was to start talking about all this stuff in Mexico. He doesn't speak English. Probably that's one of the reasons why his interviews in YouTube are mainly in Spanish. Well, basically, all of them are in Spanish. And very interesting. He's very, I would say, like, New York has some people that are very typical to New York. You can tell the way they talk, the type of language they use or the words they use, whatever. No, every place has this. So he's very, very much from Mexico City. I mean, you can tell. He's a guy from Mexico City. The way he prays, he talks, and everything. We say chilango, as you may say something to New Yorkers or whatever.
Right.
Alberto.
Chilango.
Chilango. And Chilango. He's quite funny. He's very funny, and he has a great humor. And so he makes us laugh a lot, actually. And he starts playing that the ETs have contacted them. And I want to say something about the basic information he gave us during the course. The course was a three-day-long course, and it has a lot of information. Information that is not my knowledge, is not my... I didn't get this information. I would not get much into it because if someone wants to ask questions, I would not be able to answer beyond what I learned. And this is nothing... I don't want to talk about things that I don't familiar with or which I don't know as much as is needed, you know, to discuss them. But I want to share the information that he gave us, the basic one, because it's important. ET said that they came from different parts. Mainly, there are many stars and planets and different solar systems around Alcyone, you know, the sun of Alcyone. Alcyone, I don't know if you call that in English the same.
Yes, same thing, Halcyon, yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, all right. I just want to make sure that I'm being understood.
Sure.
All right. So besides the solar system, there are many other ones. There are cyclones around Halcyon. It's like a main central sun of that area. And one of them, besides the our solar system, is the, well, in Spanish I would say Tiller. I don't know if it's Tyler or Tiller system. In the Tiller system, it is getting close to our solar system now as we approach to a certain area of the orbit around Alcyon. And that area is supposed to going to affect us quite a lot. It has to do a lot with all that we know that we've been discussing in the forum with Dolores about the Earth and the ascension of the Earth and so on. But he says that he was told by the ET that because our solar system and the Tiller solar system are getting in a conjunction, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. We call conjunction, same thing in English. Mm-hmm.
Yes. All right, good. And there's a big planet on the outer orbit of the Tiller system, solar system, which is called Barnard. That, again, is in Spanish. I don't know how to pronounce it in English. But
now, that one I don't know about. Can you say that a little slower? What's the name of that?
Yes, it's Barnard, which is B-A-R-N-A-R-D. Barnard.
Barnard. Okay.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. This planet is like 3 times the size of Jupiter. It's bigger. And it's,
wow, that's a big planet.
And its orbit, it goes between Saturn and Jupiter of our own solar system. And we are there already, touching each other. You know, the edges of both solar systems are already touching. And as we approach and get together, the influence of this big mass is going to do some changes in our own planet, modifying the axis inclination, of our planets, like in the Earth. That's because, and we know already that our axis is already shifting and moving from his original inclination that we had several years ago. We are already going to that. And it's also said that the mass of that planet is going to also affect the rotation velocity or speed, rotation speed of our planet. And that altogether causing already the climate changes that we are living through. But the ET said to this guy that all that is going to create create meteorological events so huge that will cause some catastrophes, which we are already living them, like tsunamis and earthquakes. And, you know, there was a huge hurricane that was going to crash into Mexico a few months ago. It was supposed to be the bigger hurricane ever to hit the coast of Mexico. All right. So this is what is, this guy's been told. So he was given a lot of information of what's happening, but again, what can we do regarding to that situation? How we can, you know, deal with those things personally, not as a humanity, but personally. Because one thing which I found very important is that anything that happens collectively actually is only the addition of all the individual experiences together. And everyone is different. So there's no such thing as a catastrophe. Everyone living the same experience. That's not true. That is, it doesn't happen. What happens is that everyone who experienced that catastrophe or that event, collective event, will have his own experience. And some may find heaven and some other may find hell. Depends on who you are, what's your vibration, you believe, many stuff. But it's all a personal experience. Never the same for everyone. Not cut in the same size for everyone. So, okay. So this is more or less what this guy is talking about. This is what he's explained to us that is going to cause the event. What is causing the events that we actually, what we are already living regarding to climate, to meteorological events, and many other things that are happening here in Earth, right? All right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So,
can I ask you a question? Can I ask you a question,
please.
Raul? The when you said that the ETs would take him on the ships, did he give you some details about that? Was he talking about his actual physical body going on actual physical, you know, material ET ships and going outside of our, you know, our own solar system into other realities? Did he talk a little bit about that and how that worked and, you know, how did they pick him up and did he, you know, did they just come by his house? And, I mean, how'd that work?
Well, sure. Well, he says he still keep going out with them to work, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is something important. He lives in a place, in a little mound, not so high, more like a hill. In that place, there's an ET base. He has a place that the ETs help him to buy the land and build the place. That's where he gives his courses. That's where we went, and that's where we stay for 3 days. But then he takes you out to walk into the woods, and like in, I would say, 5 kilometers away from his place, there's an ET base. And okay. So he says that he's constantly taken away in the daytime or in the dream time to work with the ETs. And he's taken to the base, or he's taken many places in Mexico to do some things with them. Of course, this is all happening in the etherical body, not in the physical body. And I understood that he was taken in the etherical body also to the ships, but it can be done. It can happen that people could be taken physically to these ships. I don't remember much details because he didn't went more than this that you said. So as far as I understood, I mean, answering your question, this is as much as I got to know.
That's fine. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. This guy,
so please continue.
Alberto. Uh-huh, tell me, please.
just please continue the story. So.
Yeah, sure. Well, he says that ETs come from different parts, Andromeda, Taygeta, in Pleiades, I don't know the names in English, Orion, Zeta Reticuli, Merope, one star is called Maya in the Alcyone Sun, it's orbiting around Alcyone, and Rigel, that's the other one. Of course, these all are names in Spanish. I hope they are the same in English or very similar, so you can understand me. But if not, okay, we'll figure out. They've been here long term. They've been working with the White Lodge, the masters of the White Lodge that work here in Earth, and other like the Galactic Conference. So they are all together, and they're just different groups of beings that are helping humanity in different ways. But they are, of course, they are all one, and they all do go by the same plan and so on. He said that the ETs that have contacted him show him that they've been teaching in Mexico, ancient time, and they were named after, the indigenous people before the Europeans came to America, they had a deity they called Quetzalcoatl, which is the feathered serpent. It's the serpent that has feathers. But he says that it actually was the name. They were referring to the ship, the starship, where the instructors of that time came, and that Quetzalcoatl was not really a deity. It was more like a group of instructors that were teaching in Mexico, in Peru, and in Brazil in that time, probably like 1,000 years ago, something like that.
Huh.
And they were teaching a lot of stuff to the people here. And this Alberto also was telling us that the ETs were showing him the work they do with the volcanoes next to Mexico City. There are two huge volcanoes. It's a couple of them, the Popocatépetl and the Isla Siwar. They have all legends about the energy, what they do to the country. It's a lot of mysticality around those two volcanoes. And they are close to Mexico City. In the past, like maybe 60 years ago before the smog time, you could see them very clearly from Mexico City, from almost anywhere. Now it's very hard because all the smog that is in the city, so it's blocking the way, but when it's clear, you can see it. And those volcanoes, they say that the energy inside the earth, it builds according to what humans do, think, or behave. And when we are so full of energy, bad and negative energy, that energy inside the earth grows, and that is causing some of the earthquakes and some of the eruptions of the volcanoes when they happen. And the ETs have been working with that energy in looking forward to avoid a huge disaster like an explosion of any of those volcanoes, which surely strike Mexico City and will affect almost all the city. It will, the lava and all the ashes and all the rocks, it will be something like Pompeia, right?
And that's a big city. How many people live there? I mean, do you know how many people live in Mexico City? That's a really big place, a big metropolitan area.
No, it's sick. It's a sick number. It's around 22 million. And I think they already lost the count.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's the fifth of the Mexican population is there, a fifth. So it's too much. It is. They say that we have already caused an eruption. If they haven't not interrupt the, by, you know, dispersing the energy that's built up inside the earth. And so this is part of the work they do. Okay. And they also said that earthquakes could have already happened. They have predicted, there's a lot of predictions around here, probably as the San Andreas fire. I'm looking for words in English. But, you know, in California, it's said that it's going to be split by an earthquake. And it's been talked about that for a long, long time. But same thing has happened here in Mexico. There's a lot of talking about explosion of the volcanoes around Mexico City and or a big earthquake. We already had one in 85, which was massive and it was really awful. And it changed the consciousness of all the country already. But it seems like it didn't do it enough. So it seems that we could have another earthquake. And these ETs are working in this country to try to harmonize and disperse the energy so those things would not happen, those disasters would not happen. And I guess it's the same thing everywhere in the world, more or less. I believe that. Okay. Mm-hmm. So Alberto, he showed us maps of the areas where those, if in the case of those disasters to happen, where they will strike. And this is something he says that the ETs, they wouldn't want him to know. They insist they didn't want him to have. But he was really, like, insisting, you have to tell me, you have to tell me, you know, people could be safe, people could be help. So why don't you give me the information? So at the end, he has some maps regarding Mexico City, regarding North America, including Mexico, Canada, United States, and also maps from Europe and maps from all around the world, where, you know, all these meteorological disasters are going to really be huge. Like, for example, the floods, which are very easy to figure out because, of course, it's in the coast of all land. But they're talking about 200 kilometers inside the land. So he has all these maps. And this is something that we, you know, we were very curious about. And it's something I asked in the session that I will talk about later, a little more. But I will finish with Alberto.
Okay.
This is more or less his main thing that he's talking about. It's a lot of more information, but I just want to have the main, the important thing, so we can move on this story. And come now, I would like now to discuss about the messages that he has received regarding how are we going to be, how can we prepare for whatever happens in the future. And there was one thing I really love about everything that he said, and that was he said that the most spiritual thing that one human being can do is being congruent between what he talks, what he thinks, what he talks, not what he do, and what he feels. And I think spiritually that's the most difficult thing to do. You know, there are people who try to live their lives in a certain way, or they have businesses, and the business is not always easy to tune on with your beliefs, because one thing is what you believe, another thing is the, you know, the economical system out there, which is not exactly the same as what we thought, or what we can be feeling, right? So making your business the same as what you're really thinking, or you're really feeling, not as easy, not so easy. So this is congruency. Is that a word, congruent, being congruent?
Yes, absolutely. So congruent, it needs to match. So what you're saying is, if you are very spiritual and you have thoughts about the way, you know, the best, the highest ways of living, that you should also have your activities and your businesses match that. So that it should be all be this, right, kind of the same.
Exactly. Well, that's what he said. That was the main message of the ETs about, you know, preparing ourselves. And I really love it because it's quite simple. I mean, you don't have to talk too much about this, but then, I mean, doing it is something else, right? It can take a whole life to just be able to achieve that. But this is quite important. And another thing that he said, which also may make very much sense to me, he says that we had to reconnect to the fundamental laws of nature. And why is that? Because nature is going to be in charge of the changes that are going to cause the world to move on to the next vibration. And specifically, he was talking about the four elements, you know, the fire, the earth, the water, and the wind. There are elements there, there are forces there, and those are going to be very, very much of a big actors of what's going to happen. Like if we talk about hurricanes, we're talking about wind. If we're talking about flood, we're talking about water. If we're talking about eruptions, we're talking about fire, and so on. So, earthquakes have to do with earth. So whatever happens, it has to do with the four elements. And he said we had to reconnect ourselves to those fundamental laws of nature. Universal laws are beyond good or bad. Have nothing to do with, and then we need the outcome.
Yes? Can you repeat that part? So what he's saying is to reconnect with nature and the universal laws, and that nature is going to be in charge of all of this change. So what is it? What part of the laws are we missing as humanity, you know, approaches this change? Did he tell us, you know, what part we're actually, you know, having trouble with?
Yes, of course. Well, first, that we are labeling laws, universal laws or natural laws, as good or bad. That's one thing that we do, because that's the way we are. But actually, nothing is done for example, the sea is bad and did a tsunami, so it will kill a certain group of people. This has nothing to do with good or bad, or because people were good, behave good or bad. It has nothing to do with those things. There are higher laws that has to do with unity. That are the source of whatever happened. And in that sense, every experience is for the best of everyone who experiences it. So it's no such thing as people will be done good or bad through these experiences, right? So we have to connect first to a higher level of these universal laws, like start thinking of those as a unity in the beyond polarity, beyond duality. We have to think about unity. We are all one, and all is of love. It comes from love. It doesn't come from bad. It comes from love. So whatever we experience in the years to come, it comes from love. It comes from our own selves, because we are all one, right? So this is a little bit of what he's saying. The other thing is that the basic forces in nature are the four elements. You know, North American Indians were very connected to those four elements. They work with fire, with earth, with water, with earth. They still do. And they flow with it. And they connected, they spoke with it, with them. And they led the life according to the laws that prevail in those four elements. Because at the end, our physical body is made out of these four elements. You can think of earth as solid. You can think of water as liquid. We can think of air as gas. And we can think of fire as plasma. Our bodies are made out of those four elements. And so they are ruled by the same laws that all nature, everything in this planet, in this three-dimensional plane of existence, are made of those four elements: solids, liquids, gases, and plasma. If you want to talk about this in a more scientific way, but we can go to the native way of speaking and say everything is made of fire, earth, water, and air, right?
Mm-hmm. And, I like that. It's easier to remember.
Yes, of course. So earth feeds our body through our food. You know, we eat solids, we eat liquids, but we also eat gas. And as the most subtle is the food is the more relevant. Like, for example, we can live without solids for a long time. We can live without liquids for a smaller time, but we cannot stop breathing for long, because then we die.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, if we lose any heat for just 1 second or millisecond, we die. We don't need to wait too much. So as the food is more subtle, it's more vital to ourselves. This is more or less what he's saying. And so we had to connect again back to those four elements. And we had to start making those elements to identify us. So when they start doing the thing they're going to do in the times to come, then, you know, we will be friends of them.
Yeah.
Enemies. It's more or less what he's saying, right?
That's really, really interesting. It must have been fascinating when you were there, courses with him, and finding out about, you know, the connection between the elements, the earth, and what the ETs were saying, giving him information to spread. Really lovely.
Yes. And, of course, every one of these elements in our own mythology, European mythology, Scandinavian mythology, you know, they have names. They have a ruler, like the fire has Agni, or the Greeks, you know, on ancient times, they all gave recognition to these elements. The Druids in Europe, they were talking about all this every time, all the time, and they recognized a force in each one of these elements. Like there was a king, or, you know, or helpers, you know, like the Silsi in the water, or the gnomes in the earth, they all were part of nature. And people in those times, they were connected to those. And they were, you know, interacting and, you know, living together, sharing life, sharing the planet with them, until we decided they were part of some ignorant way of thinking and they should go away. We disappeared them from our minds, but they're still there. They didn't disappear. It's just that we became dumb and ignorant. But they're still there. And those elements are looking forward to work with us. I mean, that's what they aim, because that's what is part of life. We're made of their own matter, from all these four elements. So ourselves are made of those, so we're part of that. It's part of our nature. We and them are part of the same nature. So teaching, Alberto was saying, was giving us way to reconnect to them. He was telling us specifically how to connect with fire, how to connect with water, how to connect with earth, how to connect with air, and that we should do it. We should talk to them and make ourselves acquaintance, or at least known by them, identified by them. We have to make them see that we are in another attitude, that we are not fighting, or, you know, being in disharmony with what they do, or with the natural laws that rule all these elements. So more or less, this is what we've been discussing with Alberto. Of course, there were much more, but if I start getting into that, it will be too much. And of course, then I'm yeah. going to feel that I'm not an expert. So I prefer not to talk too much about that.
Well, that was a really great recap of some of what he's teaching and what you all learned when you went down there and visited him. And then tell us what you did next. So just to remind our audience, yes. what Raul did was he was there with all of his friends, and about half of them were QHHT practitioners. You know, they well-versed in Dolores' method of exploring consciousness. And then I think you had a good idea, didn't you, Raul? What happened next?
Yes. Okay. So next was that we end the course. Oh, sorry. He took us to the ET-based premises. He didn't say, there's the ET base. He said, feel it. Tell me if you can tell where's the ET base. And many of us went, that was in the woods. We went in an area in nature, in the hill that where his place is set on, and we walked like 5 kilometers, and then we were out there in nature, and that's where the guy told us, okay, around here is the ET base, now spread around, feel it, and if you think that you can feel it and you know where it is, just move into the place or to the area where you think the ET base is.
Mm-hmm.
So we did that, and several of our group went to the same place. Well, the funny part was he never said, you're right, you're wrong. He says, I won't say that. I know what, there was a reason, but he didn't really want to say it. And then, here's a little story that he told us, a really funny one. I like to share.
Okay.
He said that he normally doesn't show people about, you know, he doesn't, you know, he's not so easy. He says, you can get it so easily. You really have to work, you know, and you have to make yourself to get the information, or you have to find it by yourself. But I already gave you a lot of information. I already brought you here. So it's not so difficult. That's more or less what he said. And then he told us about an occasion where there was a group that came to see him to take the course. And it was people from a city. And a lot of them were very left-brain people, you know, rational people. Now, we don't really think about we don't really believe all these stories. We don't really think that you have seen them, you know. It's nice stories, but we don't really believe that. So if you are right with this, why don't you ask the ETs to show? And then, you know, we can confirm that you're speaking the truth. So that went on for 3 days. So the last day the guy said, Alberto said, okay, so I'm going to talk to the ETs and ask them to show. So we're going tomorrow to the land, and I talked to him and asked them to show. And the guys, of the people who were the participants in the course, say, oh, yeah, great. Okay, so let's see. We talk about it when we see it. So they went outside, they went to the land, and they were, you know, all together sitting in chairs and around waiting for the big event. And then one spaceship came in and show up, and everyone ran to the place where they were taking the course and get into the cars and running away to the sea. They got so scared. No one wants to be there.
Oh, and, my.
So he says, you know, I'm not going to make it easy for you. If you really are going to see it, you're going to see it by your own resources, or because you are working with yourself and you deserve it, you're worth it. But I'm not going to make it easy for anyone, because then you don't really understand. So if it's going to happen, it's going to happen, and it has nothing to do with me. So that was more or less what he explained to us, and that's why he didn't show us where the play is. He just wants to check on us. but he didn't allow us, he didn't confirm if we were right or not, right? Okay, that's what happened with him. So when we finished the course, not so far from a big town in that state where our hotel was. Of course, we stayed in his place all the days of the course. He has some facilities where you can sleep. But when we finished, we went back to the hotel where we began before the course. And then in the afternoon, we already arranged that one of my colleagues, Norma, which is one person that connects very extremely. I mean, she goes very deep, and she gets very connected very easily to anything. So she was going to be the one who was going to do this. I was going to conduct the session, and she was going to be the subject. And I don't know how to say it, but the totally subject.
Mm-hmm.
Or the person who
That's
was
good.
Going to be the contact.
Mm-hmm.
All of my group, it was 14 of us, we got together in the room, and so we started the session. I tried to do the same that you guys did in Arkansas when I went there in the practitioner reunion when you did the thing with different people that went to sleep, to connect. I tried to have my friend already connected before they came in, but for some reason they all came in before I start. So I had to do the thing, but I already worked with her, so she has a password, a watch. And then she connected in seconds. I didn't have to do anything. Second after I connect her, she went in. She was seeing four silver sheeps already. And I say, okay, fine. But first, I want to make sure things. It's the cute thing. So I want her to ask her guy to, take a look at the sheeps and see if those were the kind of sheeps that we wanted to connect with, right? We got a confirmation. Her guide said, yes, fine, no problem. And then we asked the guy to get us someone to talk to. And immediately, in no time, there was a blue bean, 4 meters tall. That's what she said to me. And even before I asked one question, the blue bean was already taking my friend to the base and show her the base, the ET base. And she started describing it. There was a huge magnetic field, very huge in the base, and they started describing the base, which I want now to, I won't go to the whole session, but I just want to give highlights of the session, like the description of the base, the work they do, the information that they gave us. Then I asked for a message for each one of us. We got an impressive, good message for each one of us. There were 14, so it took a long time. And they talked to us about as a group. We had so much information. And then I started asking about, everyone started asking about Ingeniero Secua. They want to confirm him. So we got a lot of information also about him. So this is what I'm going to talk about next. I hope you enjoy it. Okay.
So just to recap for our audience, what Raul has done then is he and his friends got back together to the hotel, and they decided to, do a session, a quantum healing hypnosis session. And one of the best subjects for that then is now exploring one of the bases that was over near where they took the class with Alberta, but she's exploring it with her consciousness and then describing it to everyone in the room. And then messages came in, especially from this blue being. So go ahead and tell us some more, bro.
Okay, fine. This blue being was all love. As I said, it was very tall. My friend explained to us that for her it was like 4 meters tall. And eventually we asked where he was from, and he said he was from Alcyone. And, he was the oldest being in the base. He was 8,000 years old, or at least he has been there for 8,000 years old, for 8,000 years. And he's been, and he was like in charge of the base, the ET base. So my friend, the guy, the blue bean, showed my friend the base. She started describing it. She said there was like a funnel that went from the surface into the deep into the earth. That they use it to raise. I mean, it seems like she said something like it was like a vertebral. I mean, like the column, the human column that has vertebrae. How come that? Well, it has like fission along the all the length of the column, and in every length, in every session, there was different beings working, nourishing earth, and doing some work. There were also a lot of tunnels that went from that tunnel, from that column, to different parts of earth. They connected to different parts of Earth. They explained also to my friend that there was, once you get out of the tunnel of the base and you reach the atmosphere, there is a portal in the atmosphere that connects to Alcyone. And they use that portal to go to Alcyone and come back. They go forward and back. And it takes fractions of a second just to be there and come back. And these beings use the tunnel or the base that is created all along the column that goes inside the earth to raise the ships, because it seems like there were some beings from inner earth that were also working with them. And the ships came from inside the earth, and they used the tunnel to raise the ships onto the atmosphere, and then from there they will go into the portal. She said they were like one of these suction caps, you know, like octopuses, they have these suction things. I don't know the names of them.
Mm-hmm.
Bentos, I don't know in Spanish, that's the name, bentosas. But that's where the octopus used to suck, you know, and hold.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, and these things were suffering from this country. They were, you know, absorbing all the suffering, all the, like, the bad or negative emotions that came out from the suffering of the people in this country.
Huh.
She said that she also saw ships that were flying, doing figures in the tunnel, and then they went out and go around the country. Of course, these ships can make themselves visible or invisible as they wish. But mostly they are invisible because they are like in another frequency where we cannot see, or just a few people who can live in that frequency or are connected to that frequency, then they can see the ships. But the majority of the population in Mexico are not connected to those frequencies, so they cannot see the ships, but they are there. And they do the figures, and they are harmonizing, bringing harmony to the country. Okay. And they said
and,
it was also a portal. Yes.
Raul, did you say also that this tunnel where all these ships were, you know, traveling and down the vertebrae and then out to the portal and up to Halcyon, but that this big tunnel went all the way down to the core of the earth, all the way to the very core, the very center.
No. She said that down there was another portal that went to the center of the earth, but not the tunnel itself.
I see.
It was like it went to a certain depth. And then was this door or portal that can go to the center of there.
I see. Okay.
And she explained that, well, she was explained that the center of the earth, from the center of the earth, it was coming up some energy that they use for the ships. Okay, 1 second. It's coming in. Okay. Ya no discuto, pero se alargó un poquito. Okay. Bien. Okay, so I continue. You just want to teach them. Okay, so they said that the all the ships took the energy from the energy that was coming from the center of the earth. That energy seems to be the energy that we humans create, or a negative energy that if the ships wouldn't use and this base would take away, that energy will cause volcanoes to blow away, to erupt, or earthquake to happen. So by the ships taking the energy from the core of the earth, a certain type of energy, the one that is not necessary and that we have built by our ways and behaviors and thinking, they help us releasing and taking away that energy. So that was one of the reasons. Well, yes.
We have some thanks to give to them, I guess.
Definitely. Yes. Mm-hmm. You're right. We should be very grateful. She said also some vortex inside there.
Vortices?
That were mm-hmm. regulating the energy and preventing the energy to go out to the volcanoes or to the surface of the earth. So it's all, you know, the work they're doing. Well, they also saw the tunnels that they communicate with different areas of the earth. There should be another basis all about there. Or at least she mentioned that in Mexico, there are like 15 bases. I mean, no, that was Alberto's information. Told us he told us there are 15 bases in Mexico. So there's a lot around the globe, around all the planet. And they seem to be all connected. It's like, like an ants community or something like that. Okay. And then we ask why we were there. What was the reason that our group went to see Alberto Secua? And we were told that we were there to learn to discern because we have a path to walk. And I think they were talking actually about all humanity. And that path is like the truth of a person that is not nice to be there. And it gets, it closes as you rise through the truth or the passage, as you ascend through it, and it gets tougher and tougher. But we need to discern, to learn certain things. So we asked, okay, it's okay, but what was like everyone, what was the whole learning? And they said, it was each one of you learned something different. Some learned tolerance, mm-hmm. inclusion, contact with your own self, opening or open portals. Energy, ways to maneuver or to handle energy. Others learn to center themselves into very clear objectives, like we were probably very dispersed in life, you know, many things happening, family, businesses, spiritual awakening, and so on. And we need to focus and not stop being dispersed because our energy is not helping us because of that dispersion of the energy. So we need to center and focus and establish goals, specific goals, and that into the infinite, they said. Some needed to learn trust on themselves. So it was actually a learning for each one, which was different from one to the other, right? And then they gave us the message that I asked to be given to each one. We got a message each one. Then they explain us. Oh, okay. Then they say they also want us to learn how what our roles was going to be in the new world or the
Raul. Well, we're having a little technical difficulty here. Raul, I don't know if you can hear me, but...
Yes, I do.
Oh,
you?
Okay. Now you're back. We lost you there for a moment.
Okay. Okay, I repeat myself. Or maybe they didn't want me to say that.
Well, that's, you know, this is a moment that I can share this with our audience. I tell my clients who come to have QHHT sessions that primarily the sessions that have the most technical issues are the ET ones. And some I remember once setting two or even three voice recorders to record a session for an ET experiencer. And the same portion of the session was just static on all of the recorders. So if that information is not supposed to get out there, it's not going to get out
okay,
there.
We'll